2 for day 3. 2.
What?
Video 2.
On Holy Spirit baptism.
On Holy Spirit baptism. Yeah.
So let's just keep reading through these. You wanna?
Yep.
Okay, so, did we read Luke 16 yet? Read Luke 3:16?
Nope.
It's kind of all the same thing, but let's just keep reading them.
Yeah. Where is that from?
Pretty quiet.
Yeah, 3:16. All right, Luke 3:16.
John.
Let's do 3:15. The people were waiting expectantly, and all were wondering in their hearts if John might possibly be the Christ. John answered them all, "I baptize you with water, but one more powerful than I will come, the thongs of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire."
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay, so Mark 16:16.
Hey, he got changed. Dressed.
Wow.
Mark 16:16.
Mm-hmm.
All right, Mark 16:16. So this is him about to peace up into heaven. Yeah, 15, Jesus says to them, "Go into the world and preach the good news of all creation to all creation. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, but whoever does not believe will be condemned. And these signs will accompany those who believe. In my name they will drive out demons, they will speak in new tongues, they will pick up snakes with their hands, and when they drink deadly poison it will not hurt them at all, and they will place their hands on the sick and they will get well." So that's a part of what happens.
Yeah.
Wholeness. Restoration.
Power. Power too.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's, I like that one. I like that one a little bit. Okay, so how about Luke 24:49?
Yeah. Luke 24:49. All right, so this is right before he ascends again. I'm going to start at 45. It says, "Then he opened their minds so that they could understand the scriptures. He told them, this is what is written. The Christ will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance and forgiveness of sin will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. I am going to send to you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high."
Mm. You got that look, like...
Mm-hmm. Well, here it is. It says it's clothed with power from on high. You know, I think about how it's preached, like we have to put on Jesus in order for God to be able to love us. Oh, am I the only one who've heard that preached? Who's heard that preached?
About what we were talking about yesterday?
Yeah, like okay. We're, you know, you have to put on Jesus and in order for God to love us, or he loves us because he sees Jesus and Jesus is perfect. And But here, Jesus is saying, don't leave until you're clothed with power from on high. And I wonder if when we read about being clothed with Christ, if it's, you know, is this just not a coincidence, because that's silly.
Mm-hmm.
But... is this just a word that he happens to use here and clothed as something else? Or is he talking about being clothed with the power of the Holy Spirit? When we're clothed with Jesus, it's are we clothed with his spirit, with the power and ability that he had here as well, you know? Because clothes are something we put on mm-hmm. who we are.
Mm-hmm.
Who I am is reconciled and redeemed. I'm a daughter.
Okay, can you start your thought over? I'm kind of spacing out the first part.
No.
I mean, you...
Well, just, and this is something that we can talk about. Write that down. Being clothed.
Okay.
Because that's something that we can, it's a tangent.
Okay. I just... With or just being clothed?
Being clothed with Christ or clothed with power. I want to see if that ends up, we can read about it and see if it's all one thing or if it clothed just happens to be used in different ways. you know.
Okay.
Am I seeing a connection that isn't there, or is there a connection?
Okay. Okay. All right. Read that. Just that. For what does that say? Acts. Acts 19:16.
Come on, brother. You gotta help out. Acts 19:16.
Thank you.
This is when we start getting into. You'll see when it starts getting into.
Oh no.
You do it.
Me do it?
Uh-huh. All right, fine.
All right, so we'll start from 13. Some Jews who went around driving out evil spirits tried to invoke the name of the Lord Jesus over those who were demon-possessed. That's funny. Lord, Lord, didn't we drive out demons in your name? Okay, so some Jews went around driving out evil spirits, tried to invoke the name of the Lord Jesus over some who were demon-possessed. They would say, "In the name of Jesus, who Paul preaches, I command you to come out." Seven sons of Sceva? I don't know. A Jewish chief priest were doing this. One day, the evil spirit answered them, "Jesus I know, and I know about Paul, but who are you?" Then the man who had the evil spirit jumped on them, overpowering them all. He gave them such a beating, they ran out of the house naked and bleeding. So, what part are we?
Yeah, where are you at?
I'm at 13 to 16. Where are we? 7, 19?
Acts 19?
Yeah.
Acts 19, verse 16.
Yeah, so it says, the man who, with the evil spirit... is it because it said spirit? The man who had an evil spirit jumped on them and overpowered them. He gave him such a beating that they ran out of the house naked and bleeding.
That's the wrong... That's I must have written in the wrong reference. It's...
I do like verse 11 where it says, God did extraordinary miracles through Paul. No thanks.
Oh, it's 6, not 16.
Oh, okay. But hold on, I'm going to read 11 anyway. God did extraordinary miracles through Paul, so that even handkerchiefs and aprons that had touched him were taken to the sick and their illnesses were cured, and the evil spirits left them. That is the power of the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. 6!
So it's 1 through 6, you know.
Oh, so this is when, at the end of their conversation with the, his conversation with the disciples who didn't even know what Holy Spirit was.
Oh.
We have not even heard there is a Holy Spirit. What baptism did you receive? We received John's baptism. Paul said, John's baptism is the baptism of repentance. He told the people to believe in the one coming after him, and that is Jesus. On hearing this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. When Paul placed his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came on them, and they spoke in tongues and prophesied. There were 12 men in all.
And when? So that was a separate thing.
Yeah.
So they were baptized into John. Then they're like, oh, we don't know the Holy Spirit baptism. So then he baptized them in the name of Jesus and then prayed, Holy Spirit, laid his hands on them.
And the Holy Spirit,
came on them.
Yeah.
And what? Happened.
And they spoke in tongues.
Yeah.
And prophesied.
Yeah. So power immediately was in effect.
Yes.
Through one of... This is where they get it... People get into saying the doctrine, which you... I don't know at this point you can make it a doctrine of when you receive the Holy Spirit, then you automatically speak in tongues. I mean...
Because here are two separate instances. Here's an instance where Holy Spirit came on them and they immediately spoke in tongues and prophesied. And then at Pentecost, Holy Spirit came on the disciples and they spoke in tongues and prophesied. But did the other thousands of people who were baptized that day also speak in tongues and prophesied? Because that doesn't say that they did.
Let's read it. I got some more here.
Okay.
I did write down that scripture, but I didn't write down, and there were thousands of them that baptized. It's in here, though, which reference that is.
The two.
Well, let's keep on going. It's, are you talking Acts 2, 1 through 4?
No, I'm talking With many other words, he warned them and he pleaded to them, save yourselves from this corrupt generation. Those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day. That's when Peter said, repent and be baptized, every one of you, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit.
Where?
230-something or other. That was 240 and 41.
Acts 2. Where is that in here? Acts 2.
So 239? 238, I mean.
Oh.
Acts 238. Yeah, so right I'm just talking about the thousands that were added to the number that first day. It doesn't say they all
spoke in tongues.
No, okay. It just says they accepted his message and were baptized.
Okay. So you just read Acts 2, 1 through 4?
Nope. Oh. But we've read it like 30 minutes.
Okay, so how about Jude 1:20?
All right. I think we read that yesterday, too. Mm. Talking about something else. Jude 20?
Let me look right here. Yeah, 20. I'm just having you put your knees up.
But you, dear friends, build yourselves up in your most holy faith and pray in the Holy Spirit.
Which is speaking in tongues.
Yeah.
I mean, right? That's it.
I would think so. Mm-hmm. Pray in the Holy Spirit.
In the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
Okay. Acts 10:46.
All right. Oh, yeah. You were so snuggly. All right. 10:46. 10:46. Yeah. 10:46. Let's do it right. Okay, right here. Go ahead, read it.
I only wrote down partial, so you better read the whole. Oh, you asking him to. Oh.
Yeah. Yeah, sorry. All right, go ahead.
Me?
Yeah.
No, I don't want to.
Please read.
I don't want to.
I need help today.
You too.
All right, fine. I'll start with 45. The circumcised believers who had come to Peter were astonished that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out even on the Gentiles. For they heard, 46, for they heard them speaking in tongues and praising God.
Mm-hmm.
That was it. Then Peter said, can anyone keep these people from being baptized with water? They have received the Holy Spirit just as we have. So they ordered that they be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ.
That's interesting.
When they asked Peter to stay with them for a few days, then they asked Peter to stay with him. But that makes sense because that's what happened to me, is that I said I was baptized in the Holy Spirit before I ever was baptized
mm-hmm.
in water.
Mm-hmm.
So they probably wouldn't have gotten baptized at all because they were Gentiles unless there was proof to these Jews that they look at them, they're speaking in tongues and praising God, like they know they have the Holy Spirit. They have to be baptized. So that shows that we have to be baptized in water. That does
show. Can you read that again?
Yes, I can. So let me see here. Let me just read this. He's talking to.
This is Acts 10, right?
This is Acts 10, yeah. You know what? Let me go up to 34. Mm-hmm. Peter began to speak. I now realize how true it is that God does not show favoritism, but accepts men from every nation who fear him and do what is right. You know the message God sent to the people of Israel, telling the good news of peace through Christ, through Jesus Christ, who is Lord of all. You know what has happened throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John preached, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power, and how he went around doing good and healing all who were under the power of the devil because God was with him. We are witnesses of everything he did in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They killed him by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him from the dead on the third day and caused him to be seen. He was not seen by all the people, but by witnesses whom God had already chosen, by us who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to all the people and to testify that he is the one whom God appointed as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. While Peter was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit came on all who heard the message. The circumcised believers who had come with Peter were astonished that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out even on the Gentiles, for they heard them speaking in tongues and praising God. Then Peter said, can anyone keep these people from being baptized with water? They have received the Holy Spirit just as we have. So he ordered that they be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Then they asked Peter to stay with them for a few days.
Yeah.
No. I mean, that's big stuff right there.
Mm-hmm. In Mama's room?
What are you going to watch?
You have to tell me first.
A movie.
Go find one and you tell me, and then I'll let you know if you can watch it. Okay, go. You have to tell me first. Go. Find one and then tell me. Goodbye. No. VeggieTales.
VeggieTales, that's not even a movie.
Okay, you can watch a couple. I love you. He knows it's a, yeah. Off you go.
Okay, so that one is a pretty... I'm gonna highlight that one, too. All right.
Yeah.
How about Titus 3, 5-ish?
Okay. I'm kind of enjoying this whole... Oh, man, see, I have got to read this thing.
Mm-hmm.
I got to read this Bible. You know what I mean? This is so much fun because I'm reading this, and then I'm like, oh, and then he goes and he gets criticized by the Jews being like, you ate with uncircumcised men? Like, they got the word of God? You're not supposed to do that. And then he talks about the vision that he saw. I've got to read more of that. Yeah. Okay, so what, Titus?
I'm not thinking that too, Ange. We're going to jump into Acts here soon.
Acts is fun. Okay.
Titus 3, 5.
Ish.
Ish.
All right. Okay, so at one time, verse 3. At one time, we too were foolish, disobedient, deceived, and enslaved by all kinds of passions and pleasures. We lived in malice and envy, being hated and hating one another. But when kindness of love, okay, shh. When the kindness and love of God our Savior appeared to us, but when the kindness and love of God our Savior appeared, he saved us, not because of righteous things we had done, but because of his mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us generously through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that having been justified by his grace, we might become heirs and have hope of eternal life. This is a trustworthy saying, and I want you to stress these things so that those who have trusted in God may be careful to devote themselves to doing what is good. These things are excellent and profitable for everyone. I have a floppy baby. What's up?
I can't find this dress.
Oh, do you want me to help you with that?
And I feel it's almost it.
I don't know either. It might be under Papa's pillow.
I tried, it wasn't.
I don't know where it is, honey. I didn't see it this morning. Oh, that's for sure. Okay, you keep looking, though. It's in there. I know it is. So, yeah.
So he saved us according to his mercy by washing of regeneration and renewing by the Holy Spirit.
He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us generously through Jesus Christ our Savior.
Of rebirth.
Yeah, rebirth and renewal by Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us generously through Jesus Christ our Savior. So that having been justified by his grace, we might become heirs, having hope of eternal life.
Okay, I didn't quote that one very well.
Little chickens.
Okay. Oh, Acts 4:31.
What? The Believer's Prayer. All right, here I'm going to... Indeed, Herod, this was 27, and Pontius Pilate met together with the Gentiles and the people of Israel in the city to conspire against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed. They did what your power and will had decided beforehand should happen. Now, Lord, consider their threats and enable your servants to speak your word with great boldness. Stretch out your hand to heal and perform miraculous signs and wonders through the name of your holy servant Jesus. After they prayed, the place they were meeting was shaken, and they were filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God boldly. Yes, please, in Jesus' name. No. Off you go. Okay, then you can't do it.
Ephesians 4, 5.
Oh, it's right here. The next day.
Ephesians 4, 5.
Oh, it's not there. Hold on. It's somewhere else.
Like, you are there?
Nope.
You haven't flipped any pages.
I see it in my mind. Mm-hmm. It's written on my heart. I mean, it is. All right. So, 4, 5. Let me just read the whole sentence starting at 4. There is one body and one spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called. Verse 5. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father over all, who is over all and through all and in all.
What? Preach it with power so that your house shakes.
There is one body and one spirit.
Just and as, one baptism.
And one baptism. One faith, one baptism. One God and Father.
What does that mean?
One baptism is Jesus. I don't know. I don't know that yet. I don't believe that it's saying, like, it's either Jesus or the Holy Spirit. That's kind of, you know.
No.
You know, it's not like one baptism, like... I don't think this one baptism is talking about baptizing in water and baptizing in the Holy Spirit. I think that is the one baptism.
Yeah,
you
I
just
do.
Don't baptize in, it's baptizing in the name of Jesus as opposed to baptizing in any other name or whatever. That's what I think. One baptism. But there has to be a baptism. And if they were saying one baptism is... in the name of Jesus and being baptized in the Holy Spirit, that means that that has to, the both yeah. have to happen in order to have the one baptism.
Yeah. And it probably, it addresses maybe some questions of the day too. Hey, what about John's baptism? Mm-hmm. Oh, and so, and he's saying, no, there's one baptism in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
Three, you know, what we talked about before, but it's one, it's not one, there's three parts to it, but it's like the Trinity.
Yeah.
One God.
Yeah. Yoinks, what if that, I mean, what if that is, that salvation, water baptism, and baptism of the Holy Spirit is like, it's like Trinitarian.
Mm-hmm.
It's one thing. It is what is salvation. And new life in Christ,
mm-hmm.
but with three separate, distinct Ooh. Facets of
mm-hmm.
one thing.
And the Father, the fact that Jesus said, baptize in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, but mm-hmm. the Father part, too, is when the veil that was separating the Holy from the Holy of Holies, the presence, was torn.
Mm-hmm.
Now we have Abba, Father, not just Elohim and Yahweh and all these, you know,
Jehovah.
Things that kept us somewhat separated.
Yeah.
That's the gospel too. Mm-hmm. That is the gospel. So you got to have the gospel, which leads to salvation, which brings us into relationship with God,
mm-hmm.
Papa. That's why. And then the, you know, yeah. So
yeah,
this is making sense. Hmm. I like this one. I'm going to highlight. I put a question mark in my own words, but I the one baptism thing.
Yeah.
One faith, one Lord, you know?
Mm-hmm. I like that too, because one Lord is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Okay, pray at all times in the Spirit. I do not recognize you. That's Ephesians 6:18. Pray at all times in the Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
You can't not have the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
John 1:33. I don't know if we read that one. I did not recognize him. Let me read John 1:33.
Oh.
John gave his testimony. You can read it.
I saw the Spirit come down from heaven as a dove and remain on him. I would not have known him except that he was the one who sent me to baptize with water. The one who sent me to baptize with water told me, the man on whom you see the Spirit come down and remain is he who will baptize with the Holy Spirit. I have seen and I testify that this is the Son of God.
Jesus baptized with the Holy Spirit. Okay, I'm just saying this, and I'm not saying thus saith anybody.
Mm-hmm.
But maybe it's the work of man to baptize with water. Like, that's a act of not just an outward, you know, expression of an inward reality, but it's an act of obedience.
Mm-hmm.
But Jesus baptizes in the Holy Spirit. The laying mm-hmm. on of our hands. I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if that's any makes sense.
Yeah. He did. Well, I mean, I can see it where Jesus, if Jesus baptizes in the Holy Spirit, makes sense why he didn't baptize with water.
Yeah.
We baptize with water. And then he comes down and baptizes with the Holy Spirit.
You know, it'd be good to go and listen to, remember Paul Keith Davis did a whole teaching on this, how we baptize incorrectly.
I don't remember.
Yeah, he did a whole webinar on it and I can't remember what he said. He was talking about how we baptized in the wrong names or whether it wasn't the fullness. So it'd be interesting
to
see what he says. Okay, so just a few more. Wow, I just keep on going and going. Like Acts 10, can I just briefly, or should we keep going? Acts 10:44, while Peter was still speaking, the Holy Spirit fell on them. I think we already read that one.
Yeah.
Of those who are listening. In John 20:22, he breathed on them and said to them, receive the Holy Spirit.
Yeah, that was when he first came down and said, peace to you. That was on day one. Like the day he was resurrected, he came in. Remember, he saw Mary.
Oh, let's read it then.
Yeah, because that was, where is that?
John 20.
Yeah. We were talking about that he, it was a busy day for him because Mary was standing outside the tomb. Jesus was there. He said, don't cling to me. I haven't yet gone to my Father. Then he walked with his disciples, but they didn't recognize him. And then he left and then he came back and was like, I've, you know, here, have the Holy Spirit. That he put his blood on the mercy seat on that day and then came down. And all right, so do not cling to me. Hold on, that's over here. Okay. That's the ten. On the evening of the first day of that week, when the disciples were together and the doors locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came down and stood among them and said, peace be with you.
I'm sorry, where are you?
I'm 20. Oh, 2010?
2010.
The disciples went back to their homes, but Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and one at the other. But what you were talking about when he said, peace be with you, was...
Oh, I thought you were going to read back further when you... Because you're talking about when Jesus married... So you're just talking about the whole event of the day.
The whole day, yeah. Okay. But then in the evening, Jesus came and stood among them. This is 19. And said, peace be with you.
Okay.
And he said, after he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Then Jesus again said, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you. And with that, he breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone his sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven.
So this is before Pentecost.
Yeah, and we had talked about... Do you remember us talking about this?
Say it again.
That he breathed on them. The way that... when I read this, it's like he breathed on them the way that God breathed into Adam. Receive life.
Oh.
You know? So he breathed on them. Receive the Holy Spirit. Receive life. Ezra,
honey, that's not going to shut.
It's good. Just leave it be. Yes, Mama. I said leave it be. Oh, all right. Go to your room. Oh, good. Okay, so... So we were talking about the difference between Jesus breathing on them and saying, receive the Holy Spirit, and then the power of the Holy Spirit coming down on them 10 days later at Pentecost, because they were walled up in that room for 10 days waiting for the gift that the Father had for them, that Jesus had talked about. They had to wait before they were sent out, before they could go out and be his witness. But on that first day... Not 10 days later, I'm sorry, 50 days later. Because it was after he ascended that they waited another 10 days for the Holy Spirit. 40 days.
Oh, 10 days?
10 days after Jesus ascended. So it was 50 days in all. The day he was resurrected, he comes in, breathes on them, says, receive the Holy Spirit, then spends 40 days with them, revealing himself to 500 people. Yeah, over the course of those 40 days. And then at the end of those 40 days, he said, wait for my Father to give you the gift that I've talked to you about, which is the Holy Spirit. He ascended, and then they hold themselves up in this room for 10 days in Jerusalem. And then on Pentecost, the Holy Spirit fills them. And they speak in tongues and prophesy, and thousands, 3,000 people, you know, come to know the Lord. But it was 50 days after... Jesus breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. So, did they have new life in them for that? I mean, like, he pled, you know, he put his blood on the mercy seat. It's done. It's finished. Peace be with you. Receive the Holy Spirit. So, you know, it's, so this well, is I, where
you,
we
you've
could...
Let, I, you've, I... We have never talked about the blood on the mercy seat. I know that you have talked about it, and I think... So, but that's, to me, that's like another topic.
That is another topic.
What you're saying is...
This isn't the power, this isn't the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. I don't believe that when he breathes on them and says, receive the Holy Spirit, that it's a baptism of the Holy Spirit. The baptism of power, I think it's the reception of the Holy Spirit, like... They're receiving Holy Spirit as in, like, you're now saved and have... I don't understand it! Never mind. I know that there was a... I mean, I believe that there's a difference.
There has to be, because why would he do it twice if it's the same thing?
Yeah.
So
like, yeah. I've heard, you know, I've heard in conversation that when people are saved... Holy Spirit comes and makes his home in them, right? But that doesn't mean that they've been baptized with power. So that's what I'm thinking that this is, that they've been saved. Jesus saved them. He came back down. They're saved now, received the Holy Spirit. So he's making their home in them, but to receive the power of the Holy Spirit, to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit is something different. That's what I see here.
Well, before he breathed on them,
they weren't saved. What? He hadn't finished what he had come to do. How could they be saved? He hadn't fulfilled what he.
So they were still. Oh, jeez. I'm like, argh.
I mean, I. So what? I mean,
Jesus hadn't done the work.
Yes. They weren't saved because of what...
No, he did. Because this is after he rose from the dead.
That's why they're saved now. That's why he breathes on them and says, receive the Holy Spirit. Now you're saved. I just finished it. He came back down from putting his blood on the mercy seat. Done. Receive the Holy Spirit. You're good. But up until then, they weren't, because he hadn't completed what he had set out to do. I mean, it's like they weren't saved when he was hanging out with them and he was still alive before, you know? When he was a man, they weren't saved.
Well, they were saved under the... Well, they were under the old covenant at that point still.
Yeah, but they weren't saved. Like, as in, they weren't... They weren't saved by Jesus. They weren't saved. That's what I mean. It's not about, you know, old covenant versus new covenant. Like, Jesus...
Am I being early elementary here?
No, no, no. It's... But I think it's... It's like we look at the disciples and go, they're the disciples. But we don't consider that before Jesus died and was resurrected, they were just men. Jewish men who were trying to observe the law. And after Jesus died and was resurrected, they were saved. And they received the fullness of the Holy Spirit, and they walk in what they were called to do.
Well, they walked in it before. They walked in it in Matthew and Mark and Luke and John. Before he died on the cross.
As orphans, not as saved apostles filled with the Holy Spirit. They weren't filled with the Holy Spirit then.
Okay, so how were they, I mean, I'm asking this, how were, and I'm not thinking this, I'm just asking you at this point, and we will think through it. How were they doing the works of Jesus in before this happened?
I don't know how that works yet. I haven't been given revelation. I mean,
they cast out demons in his name
because his name has power, but I don't know how. I haven't received revelation on that yet. Mm-hmm. But I do know that they did not have the Holy Spirit in them.
Well, Jesus it could be also that...
What, honey? Sorry. Oh, I thought he was saying he needed to go to the bathroom. You can get out and read a book. Or a color. But no TV. Sorry, go ahead.
Even in the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit came upon them at different times.
But it doesn't even say here that the Holy Spirit came upon these disciples and enabled them to do it. Jesus commissioned them to do this in my name, and they did it in his name, and...
So he was there.
Yeah.
I mean, they had to have... them,
but...
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm just saying that they had to... They weren't operating on their own. They had the...
No.
They had his name,
mm-hmm.
And maybe it was just that simplicity that he was there with them still at that point. Mm-hmm. He had not left, and so that the Holy Spirit would have to...
They were under his authority, and so maybe it was that. They were walking in the authority of Jesus, that Jesus had commissioned them, that Jesus had given them, do this in my name, I have given you my authority, right?
Mm-hmm.
So go ahead and do it. And so they got to do it, but they were doing it as orphaned men, as men who were not saved and had the fullness of the Holy Spirit, the mind of Christ. And I mean, they didn't have that kind of relationship with him yet. They had a physical relationship with him, but not a Holy Spirit abiding and dwelling in them relationship until after he, died and was resurrected. And breathed on them, and they received the Holy
Spirit.
This
is good. I've never thought about this.
I mean,
I guess I assume a lot of things when I read the word. Because we have it in the fullness here.
Yeah. Yeah. But when, like, Peter, when people go, man, I can relate to Peter, mm-hmm. And Dan Moeller talks about this a little bit, like, which Peter are you relating to? Are you relating to Peter before he was saved? Are you relating to Peter, the guy who was always putting his foot in his mouth and cutting off, you know, a soldier's ear and, like, always getting a rebuke from Jesus? Because, mm-hmm. Or are you talking about the Peter who was saved, who, like, established the church? And, mm-hmm. you know, which Peter do you relate to? Because we're only meant to relate to the one who was walking in the fullness of the Holy Spirit, who had been saved. Not orphan Peter, but son Peter.
Mm-hmm.
And the disciples were orphans until Jesus died and resurrected, and they were then sons.
I would want to go back and read this with that.
Yeah.
Thought.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean,
that's Dan Miller teaches that?
He talks about the Peter thing, yeah. But right. Again, it's like, look at the way that they treated each other, they acted. Mm-hmm. You know, it was still under, they were all under Jewish law. Mm-hmm. You know, even Jesus. Like, there was Jesus, everyone had to abide by the law. You know, they were still under the law until the time came where Jesus was crucified and resurrected and fulfilled the law.
Yeah.
But up until he fulfilled the law, everyone was under the law. It's not like just because...
Yeah, but Jesus kind of broke... He kind of got... He wasn't under the... I mean, like the law of hand washing and why do you guys work on the Sabbath? I mean, those were laws. Mm-hmm. And Jesus broke... He was already going... The law is bigger than this.
Mm-hmm.
So I think there was already... He was already showing the way of...
Yeah, and he gave explanation to that, too. Like, that he's the bridegroom, and you don't have to, you know... You don't fast when the bridegroom is with you, you know. But when I'm gone, they will, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And talking about being clean versus washing your hands to make yourself clean, or the stuff that it's what's in you that makes you clean or dirty, not the food, you know, that's around you that makes you clean or dirty. So there was a lesson in those things. But I mean, even in Galatians 4, it says that Jesus was born under the law, you know, I mean, it says, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under law, to redeem those under the law, that we might receive full rights as sons.
Mm.
So he was born under the law so that he could redeem us who were under the law, so that we could become sons. And that includes the disciples. They weren't sons until he finished his work.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's what does make that clear.
Oh, stuff to think about.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. So this all started when we were reading John 20, 22. And all what, I mean, really, okay, so here's another topic that I want to dig into, because is all the stuff that happened on that day that he rose. Because I remember asking in my lifetime, like, I get that the fact that he rose again was... He conquered death.
Yeah.
But what is the significance of this, of the resurrection, that I don't have a revelation about? I don't understand most of it, I don't think. Because it wasn't, I mean, I'm saying this, that I thought this in my life. Like, I don't think I get the significance of what happened at the resurrection. Because because it feels not big enough to me. Like, I don't get it.
Yeah.
But... what we're talking about right now, starting at the empty tomb.
Yeah. Wait.
And you're talking about...
Wait.